Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Michelle Nadu. I'm a senior systems analyst at Macquarie University in Sydney. And my talk to you today is going to be about resource sharing partner synchronization. The context around this is primarily around Australian libraries. However, it might be beneficial to other people as well, because I've been learning a lot about how other countries and regions basically do resource sharing. It's very different to how we do it. So, this might not really apply to you, but there's a broader context that I want to talk about as well, which is about third-party services and how we can basically use community-based third-party services. But it kind of becomes more clear as I go along as to how that's going to work. So, basically, In Australia, the previous system we've been using is called the VDX system, which is a third-party system. It's outside of Almas, it's outside of Primo, and it has a few issues with it. So there's not great stuff is that it's an external system, requires external login for a person, so a person has to log into a completely different system, which means if you want to have our students log into that system, that means we have to have integrations between like our campus authentication and that system. So the VDX system has had, we've had additional user management integrations to it, we've had had to customize our AD so that it can communicate, we've had to extend our schema, so we have to add custom attributes to it. It was quite painful to do, especially trying to get all that stuff through our central IT, which didn't really want to do any of that stuff. However, some of the good things it does is all the partners around Australia and New Zealand, so it's Australia and New Zealand, are all managed through the external system. So that's something we never really had to worry about before. And there's about 1,200 partners. So that the VDX system basically took care of what the contact details for those people were, what the postal addresses were, if those things changed, and what changes more regularly is whether those people are suspended or not. In other words, whether they're still offering resource sharing services or not. And that changes on a pretty much daily basis with some organizations. So we had a look at moving to Alma. And Alma is great because it's a single system, right? It supports multiple protocols for communicating between your partners. And the end user experience is much nicer. So no longer does a student have to log into an external system to have a look at what they what the status of the requests are for any interlibrary services, they can have a look straight up on Primo. And there's a section on Primo which shows you this is the status of your request. From our perspective, we didn't have to do any additional user integration with the external system because it's all in there, it's all in Primo, it's all in Alma. And no additional user management either. So that was really great. The not so great thing was the 1,200 partners that were managed externally. We realized that, hey, if we want to actually use this, we have to manage those 1,200 partners ourselves. So that was quite painful. That was pretty much speaks for itself, really. It's painful managing 1,200 partners. So just going through some of the connection options that we have between communicating with our different partners. We've got two kind of models. You've got like a broker versus a peer-to-peer. In Australia, we use Australia and New Zealand, although New Zealand uses a different broker, but in Australia, we connect two New Zealand libraries through the same broker. And through the broker, all requests to a partner go through the intermediary, the broker, and the connection configuration for each partner points to the broker. And the broker handles all the billing, which is primarily why we use the broker. In a peer-to-peer system, your library system connects directly to another library. And Alma handles both those configurations. But as I said, within the Australian context, we pretty much all use, not all of us, but most of us use the broker. So Macquarie University, we use LAD, which is Libraries Australia Document Delivery, as the broker, and again, that's primarily because of the billing. So what happens is everybody sends their requests to other libraries through the broker. The broker kind of captures those requests and twice monthly sends a bill to various people. Because each request costs a certain amount of money. Yeah. So based on the number of requests you've serviced, requests you've sent, the total bill, whether it's positive or negative, will be sent to you twice monthly. So that's kind of why we use it. Now, as I said, there's about 1,200 libraries within Australia and New Zealand that that do resource sharing amongst each other. And there's only about, I think, 53 or 54 libraries that actually use ALMA. So because of that, we can't really use ALMA to ALMA type communication. We pretty much go to a broker because there's lots of different systems. Everybody talks to the broker. So, managing partners. So basically for managing partners, there's basically two pieces of information we really need. We need contact information for all the partners in Australia and New Zealand, and that would contain obviously addresses, phone numbers, email addresses. And the second piece is the suspension status. So we need to know whether a partner is currently accepting requests. So in case they are, say, moving libraries or closing down for a holiday, or they're low on staff, could be any number of reasons why they might want to suspend services for a certain period of time. Sometimes it's only a few days, sometimes it's a whole year if they're migrating systems. I see more than 6 to 8 months, so it varies. But more common are the week closure here or there. But it happens quite regularly, and across 1,200 partners, you can imagine there's a lot that goes up and down. So, the question, where's all the data? So when I got the request to say from our library staff saying, okay, we need to figure out, is there a way to load resource partners in ALMA? And I'm like, yeah, I've actually seen the resource partners API. I'm sure we could do it. Where's the data? And, well, the data for LAD, Australian libraries, is sitting on this web page. There's no other access to the data on the back end. That's where you see it. The data for addresses and contact information for Australian universities is stored in a directory called ILRS, which is the Australian Interlibrary Resource Sharing Directory. And you basically take a NUC symbol, which is your National Media Catalog symbol, search for it, and it brings up another page, which obviously has all your address and contact information there. Not pretty. And the HTML on the back's not pretty either. With the New Zealand contact information, it gets a bit better because this is a CSV which is accessible online. So there's a URL, points to a CSV, and you can pull it down and you can get all the contact information you need. However, the suspension information is sent as an email. So you register for an email service, and every time a suspension occurs, it basically sends you an email saying, this is the institution, it's the begin suspension list, this is the suspension codes and dates, and there's lots of these that come through through the system. So those are the four sources of data basically we had to work with. It's not pretty. Basically, to get the data, I have to go into the screen, I have to basically load the page, scrape the data, and extract the information from within. For that, for the ILRS system, I have to go and make a, each of these NUC symbols represents a particular organization. In the Australian section, there's about 740, just over. In New Zealand, there's about another 450, close to 500 around there. So you take the NUC symbols here, and then you've got to do a search for every NUC symbol to grab the page, and then parse the page and extract the information. So that's just the Australian side of things, and obviously the New Zealand one, this is a bit easier, you just parse a CSV file, and this is not so easy because you've got to connect your email system with authentication and stuff, and we use Office 365, so that takes it to a different level of complexity. However, the solution design, so what I decided to do is basically take the data from these four sources, and as common friends would probably say, it's pretty much a natural solution where you harvest the data and put it into a data store. So that's what we do. So basically scrape the data on a regular basis, maybe 2-3 times a day. I don't scrape ILRS 2-3 times a day because it introduces stability issues into their system. So I've decided to basically do that once a week with a really quiet time and take it as easily as possible because I think I have broken their system a couple of times during the COVID. So that, to put an email address, that's just continually happening, happens like 5-6 times a day. So it harvests all that data and sticks into the data store. Okay. So just quickly go over the technology stack that I'm using at the moment. So the data store, I'm actually using an Elasticsearch cluster sitting on top of Kubernetes. That's a local library setup that we use. I'm actually just kind of borrowing our Elasticsearch instance for this kind of stuff. The Hofstra application itself, it's a Java application. It uses the Java, a Jazzy web client, and uses JaxB for handling the representations of the data. And for deployment, it's just a scheduled job, and it's a Java executable, which means it can be run from anywhere. As long as that place has access to the Elasticsearch data store and the internet, you can pretty much run it from anywhere. It goes and grabs the data from the various web pages and loads them into the data store. Now, this is a data representation of a partner in the data store. As you can see, we say the NUC symbol, the stuff in the blue is stuff that comes from the LAN website, and the stuff in the green is the stuff that comes from the ILRS directory. The suspension stuff for the LAN, as I said, LAN doesn't give you a, it just tells you suspended, not suspended, and this is the data for suspension. It doesn't give you a lot of information. The Tapuna side says, okay, I'm going to be suspended from this date. It can give it to you in advance. So it can give you a whole series of suspension dates in advance. So basically, I take all those dates from the Tapuna side of things and store them. And when I'm calculating the status, it calculates based on all the suspensions that are calculated. It just goes to the ball, says, are you suspended? It just follows the pattern. So it checks the dates that it's currently at and whether you're suspended or not, and it updates that suspension status. So that's basically where the data comes from, right? So we've got LAD or Tapuna. Again, suspension information is from the LAD page or the Tapuna email, and the addresses are either from the Tapuna CSV file or from the ILRS directory. Now, every single time there's a change in the data, so if somebody changes their name of the organization, very rare, somebody changes their email address, less rare, there's a change log. So we track, we audit every change that happened in the system. Here you can see the first one is a change of name. This actually happened about 2 or 3 days ago, where the organization from Tapuna changed the name from Pipfruit New Zealand Inc. Information Resource to New Zealand Apples and Pears Incorporated Information Resource, for example. So it tracks obviously the time that the load was run, not the actual time that somebody would enter the data. And it tracks the source of the system, the name of the field that was changed, the organization, and the before and the after picture of what the data was. So similarly, there's an example here which shows you the change of an email address, which is like the main email address for this organization. It's also changed because they've changed their domain name as well, it seems. And here's a totally separate example, which is the adding of a suspension. So it shows you that, I found a suspension and I'm adding it to the record. And it shows you that for this particular organization, coming from this system, there's a specific suspension that has entered the system. So that's pretty much, that's the harvester side of things. So we've broken this up into two separate applications. One application just harvests the data and stores in the data store. And the second half of the application is a service which synchronizes data from the data store with your Alma instance. So the solution designed for this is, for the synchronization component, is we call a service on the sync API. We pass in API key, and the API key has to have read and write access to your resource partner's API. And obviously you have to provide your NUC symbol so I know which configuration to pull. We'll get to that in a second though. So here we go. So basically your institution calls the sync service. The sync service requires your Alma API key and your NUC symbol. Your sync service then pulls all the data for all the partners from the data store. Right? And it also loads your config data, and I'll get to the config data in one of the upcoming slides, but there's a configuration for your specific institution, because there are some things where the institution can actually customize certain attributes for how they want to handle document deliveries. We'll get to that again in a second. And obviously it loads all the partners from the data store, and then the third step it does is it pulls all the partner information from Alma. So it grabs all your resource partners from Alma. And then the sync service creates basically partner record from the data store. So the data store representation is not an exact copy of what ALMA is. It just got a bit more additional information. The ALMA data store representation, sorry, the ALMA representation of your partner is exactly as on the XLibris developers website, where it shows it has the XML structure and the JSON structure for your partner records. So it uses exactly the same thing from the ALMA perspective. So what happens is the SYNC application pulls the data from the data store, converts all that data into an ALMA representation, and then does a comparison. So it does a field by field comparison. Every single field in the ALMA record is compared with every single field in the data that's coming from the data store, and it creates a change list. So every field that changes, again, it uses the same record structure for this change and records every field that's going to get changed into the data store. And then obviously it says, okay, yep, there's some changes in this record, so I'm going to update it. So it finds changes in the from the data store to your ALMA. If there's any differences, it will then update your ALMA instance with the new data from the data store. And again, that's also logged as well. Again, the technology stack, similar. Well, basically, the data store, again, the same data store, so obviously the same technology stack. We use Kubernetes and Elasticsearch running on top of that. For the SYNC application itself, I use something that's similar to Spring Boot, but not quite. It's kind of the analogous to it. It's Java, Juice, which is Google's dependency injection framework, JaxB, which I use for the conversion of objects into XML and or JSON. Jersey is the REST-based application server, which handles a lot of the requests. And Grizzly is kind of the embedded HTTP runtime server, which effectively enables me to create the SYNC application as a Java executable, which runs as a server, so listens on a port so that you can connect to it as an API service. And again, deployment, you can deploy it as a Docker container onto Kubernetes behind an API gateway called Kong. So that's all, you can look at all that on the net. That's fairly basic software, basically. So that's the technology stack. Now, I mentioned earlier that there's a configuration that every organization has to have, if you use this. But this configuration allows you to customize what your ALMA partner is going to look like in your system. So as I said, it pulls data from the data store, pulls your config from the data store, creates an ALMA representation using both those pieces of data, and then it does your comparison with ALMA. So in this configuration, you get to set up basic things like what you want the link base for your your resource partner to be, what currency you're operating in, where the borrowing is supported, where the lending is supported, what workflows you're using, what the average supply time, delivery delay, what locate profiles you guys are using for interlibrary, what protocol you're using, and settings for those protocols. So as you can see, this is the Macquarie University config. This is our ISO ILL server. It's basically, that's the LAN gateway, and various other ISO-based configuration details in there. So depending on your configuration, you don't even have to use ISO, you can just use one of the other protocols as well if you want. So just add those configuration values in there. And when it's building the representation of your resource partner, you will use that instead. And as I said, in our case, for most Australian libraries, we will be using ISO because that's what the LAN gateway operates on. So, endpoints. Again, not quite finalized yet. Just finished kind of getting it all working about 2 weeks ago. I need to do a bit more work on it. Everything at the moment is just a post, and I'm passing the API key as part of the post body. I will move that to a header file at some point. It was just easier for me to get to as a post while I was doing development. And the post will return into gets once the API key is used in the header. But basically, these are the four endpoints that I've got so far. There might be more coming in the future. But you're not forced to just automatically sync your instance. You can actually have a preview of it first. So when you run the preview, it actually shows you what will change. It gives you a list of all the records that are, so the new version of all the records that will be changed. So if you've got 1,200 partners, only four of them change, you will get a response back with these are the four partners that will change. If you're doing the first time load, it's going to give you 1,200 partners that have been changed. The changes endpoint, that actually gives you a list of all the change records. So I showed you the change records earlier here. It gives you a list of these. So for the change records for an institution, basically, the source system will be Your organization's NARC symbol, so in Macquarie University's case, will be NMQU. And the change for the NARC will be the partner, resource partner that has changed relative to your system, and then the field and the data that's changed as well. So that's what the changes API endpoint does. It gives you a list of all the change records, so you can identify field by field what changes have occurred in your sync. And another thing I don't do is I don't delete any partners. So if your partners are no longer active, or your partners never were in the data store, or never have been harvested, or you've got external partners, there's an endpoint called Orphan, and it gives you a list of all your resource partners that aren't in the data store. So these are partners that I've not seen before, the system hasn't seen before. So you can then go and decide what you want to do with that, whether you want to delete them, whether they're there, whether they're your test partners or whatever, up to you. But yeah, I choose not to delete anything because I don't like deleting stuff from people's systems. And this here's just an example of what it would be like to call this service, basically. It's just not about just you can just use curl or whatever tool you like to make an API call. As I said, the currently it's a post request, and I'm passing the API key. That's not a real API key. Into the body of the message, but in the future it'll be, instead of there, it'll be as a header, and I plan to use exactly the same format that Exlibris uses for passing the API key, so it'll be no different. what else can I talk about? How much for time? Okay, so future directions. At the moment, as I said, it's a service that's hosted in our local system. There's no actual external endpoint that's available currently working on that. But I would like to actually just host this in AWS, and that way it's kind of open to everybody. It would be easier. The data store I'd like to use, obviously, is just put everything on Amazon, basically. So run an Amazon Elasticsearch service, run the application as Lambda functions, because there's no state involved apart from what it puts into the Elasticsearch data store. So there's no reason why this couldn't be run as Lambda functions. And then have an API gateway on AWS to then point to the Lambda functions, which can accept, obviously, the requests and handle them. So you can do your syncs, your previews, your changes, your orphans, and the harvester up that can be run from anywhere as long as it has access to the internet and has access to the data store. So this is our current technology stack. This is just an FYI. Run VMware locally with Kubernetes on top, and then a whole lot of containers, running Elasticsearch containers, Kibana, and the resource sharing partner sync service as well. That's pretty much about it. So as I mentioned before that, before we get to questions, I mentioned before that there's a broader topic here of third-party services. So this could be basically viewed as like a third-party service model, where there's an API, which works pretty much in a very similar way to how an Exlibris API might work. Not exactly, we can treat the endpoints and formatting and all that sort of stuff. But the concept is that you take your instance API key, pass it to a service, and have that service do something to your Alma instance. And I thought that would be a good point to launch a discussion about what people think about that, and whether it's like something that you might find valuable, and whether Exlibris might find that valuable for people to use, rather than just having bits and pieces of software and code. You can actually have a service that's sitting out there that you can use for your institution as well. And that's it for me. Thank you. Questions?
This looks great. I'm tired just listening. All you had to do to make those research sharing partners sync. So good for you. And obviously, it's the service they can use. The intention is to be used by other institutions in Australia and New Zealand. What do they have to do in order to take advantage of it? Do they have to do ALMA configuration changes? Do they have to move their resource sharing partners from the external system into ALMA? How ready is this for us?
So basically, at the moment, I think a lot of organizations in Australia are actually planning on doing this. So they are actually planning on moving to ALMA. I know we've already been speaking to a few of them who are interested in how this would work. From what they have to do from their perspective, so they have to configure, obviously, their borrowing profiles, so all the stuff that was in the configuration, these are basically all the settings that they have to basically have in their system, and then they have to tell me what the settings are, or give me a config that they've done. And then I put the config in our system, and against their Nuxable, and then when they call using their API key and their Nuxable, then it basically just works.
This could be used with the initial load as well.
It could be used with initial load as well, correct. In fact, yeah, we use it for the initial load. And if anyone's interested, I'm happy to demonstrate our syncing, our sandbox with this later during lunch or whatever. I'm happy to sync your sandbox if you haven't considered it. So, yeah, just let me know if you're interested. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's good.
Are all clients in your system are single libraries, or there are some consortia that they implement another sharing model?
There's multiple.
And if yes, how they integrate it in your system?
We're a single library, so most of this, and most libraries are single libraries, and there's a few consortia. I only recently learned about the network zone about 2 days ago from Moshi's talk on resource sharing partners, so I'm not 100% sure how that would work or how that actually works in the broader context of syncing partners. Something I'll have to look into in the next few weeks. But we don't actually, most of the libraries around Australia don't use the network zone. It's only the consortia, and there's just a few of them who actually use the network zone.
Yeah, this is more an observation than a question. I think an application set up like this would be useful in very many countries. But one of the observations is that the harvesting part, where you have to harvest four sources of data, will of course vary from country or to region, from region to region. What I also see is that in a country or region where there is a national register of ILO partners, it should be able for one partner, one library to do this and supply it as a service to others or build an application that can be used by others.
Absolutely agree. Yeah. I agree 100%. This is like the ugliest source of getting data you could possibly imagine. And then you come off the ILO directory and then you see, oh no, it gets ugly. So, sorry, question bit.
Hello. Thanks, first of all, for this very, very inspiring look on your way of integrating services. I think that's probably quite a prototype for integrating with a service like Armor in general. I mean, it's just a comment, it's not a question, but what I liked really much is the integration of the messy systems via rather clean interface to the not so messy systems to get things robust and flexible. Yeah. So that was very cool. Thank you.
So I'm just curious with Relay looking to sunset BDX, how are
part of the driver? That was part of the driver, but not that we use Relay. I think that everybody seems to be sunsetting BDX.
Right. Yeah. I'm wondering kind of how you see the development of the service going. Are you thinking about kind of centrally managing it in terms of how people are contributing to their profiles and everything? Because Relay is very different than VDX.
That's further discussion. So this is like first draft. This is like actually working. It's working for us. I haven't even moved to the level of actually trying to see somebody else's sandbox or production system yet. Haven't even been up to our production system yet, still in testing in our sandbox. But moving on from there, yeah, I'd love to know what other people would like to see, what features would be useful for them. At the moment, it's just from our context only, but I've tried to make it as generic as possible. So there's nothing Macquarie University specific in any of this. So if you could, yeah, so my next step would be to find people who would be interested in trialing this out, so get a couple of other organizations. I'm sure there's people here possibly put their hand up to help. And you could trial it out and see how it goes, and then build from there what the requirements might expand to, what's missing, what people would like to see, maybe even other systems. I'm not sure. Yet. So ideally, the ideal thing is actually to get some decent data sources. But as you can see, that's, I'm not sure what the end game for that is going to be. But this is kind of like an interim solution. Until something better comes along, I guess. Any other questions?
Any questions back of the house? This isn't a question, but as an Australian-based library thank you.
Welcome.
And I will definitely put my hand up to test out something else, sandbox with this.
Excellent. Glad to hear that. Good.
One more.
I'll brief a question with my very croaky voice. So earlier in the presentations at the conference, this term global partner list came up.
I did, yeah. Again, it was the first time I've heard those things, so but yeah.
So can anyone answer? Can anyone answer how that concept relates to this work that she's done?
Resource sharing partners can be managed at a network level if you're a member of a consortium, and then distributed or synced with member with institutions that are members of that same consortium. So in this model, for example, just off the top of my head, you might want the sync service to synchronize with the network, and that could take care of the work to manage the rest of the institutions. But that only works at the consortium level, so you still need this service to sync with individual libraries
or with a network.
Any other questions? Excellent. Thank you very much.